Welcome to Azure IaaS Day. My name is Charlie Wen. I'm a program manager on Azure networking team. Today, I'll be talking about hybrid networking. I'll give you an update on new features, new services, and also talk about some best practices. These are the services I'll cover. Some of the services are fairly new. I'll spend a bit more time on them. But we'll begin with VPN. Now, Azure VPN has two products. One is called Point-to-Site VPN. It connects you or your device to Azure. Another service product is called Site-to-Site VPN. Site-to-Site VPN connects your branch office to Azure. Point-to-Site VPN is also called the Remote Access VPN. It requires a VPN client to be installed on your user's machine. What's new here is we have a new VPN client for macOS. You can download this app from Apple Store. This client is built on top of an OpenVPN protocol. The OpenVPN protocol supports many features, such as Azure AD authentication. Now, for advanced user, this software also has some troubleshooting wizard. You can also use this software to customize your DNS and routing policies. Now we move from the client to the server. The new Point-to-Site VPN server supports multiple authentication types on a single gateway. So now this expands the user base because users of many organizations are on different OS, Linux, Windows, macOS. Each of these OS has its own default authentication software. Some is based on certificate, some is based on Azure AD. With this feature, you only need to deploy one gateway for all of your users rather than one gateway for each type of OS. So now let's look at the Site-to-Site VPN. Site-to-Site VPN connects your branch office to Azure. An important feature we introduced is NAT, Network Address Translation. Now, Network Address Translation, NAT, is designed to address the address overlapping problem between your network and Azure. NAT is a fairly old or mature technology. I won't deep dive into that. What I do want to call out is our NAT has two configuration options. One is static NAT and the other is dynamic NAT. Which type to use depends on your application's communication pattern. If your application has this server-to-server communication pattern, meaning that if VMs in your on-prem and the VMs in Azure both will initiate connection to the other side, then you need a static NAT. However, if your applications follow the server and the client communication pattern, you only need a dynamic NAT. Now, for more details, you can look at this document, aka.ms/vpn-nat. Besides NAT, we also have other new features. If you are on VPN Gateway 4 and 5, you can configure up to 100 tunnels. You can also configure multiple BGP tunnels using a PIPA address. A PIPA address is required by some other cloud service providers. So with this feature, if you are a user, if you have a deployment on multiple clouds, you can now set up multiple tunnels. Overall, we have improved the monitoring and the diagnostics for VPN. If you log on to Azure portal, you will see a BGP dashboard. You can find all the active BGP sessions there. You can see the routes advertised and received by your VPN gateway. As an advanced user, you can also do packet capture on the portal. You can also manage IPsec tunnel independently. For each IPsec tunnel, you can manage them independently. So that's VPN. Now I want to change gear and talk about ExpressRoute. In contrast with VPN, which traverses over the public internet, ExpressRoute is a private connection. Once you are on ExpressRoute connection, you have access to all Azure. Plus countries, and we continue to expand our ExpressRoute POPs to new countries, new markets. I want to spend some time to talk about new ExpressRoute capabilities. Now, for the past year or so, we've been focusing on IPv6, security, performance, and manageability. IPv6 is pretty fairly straightforward. IPv6 is designed to solve the IPv4 exhaustion problem. But we also found IPv6 is enabling new scenarios in 5G mobile and IoT space, and we are hopeful adoption will pick up over time. Now, on security, We are the first cloud service provider that introduced the MaxSec. We have added new features like new ciphers and new capabilities to support the old hardware. So now if you're on some old hardware, there's a good chance you can also enable MaxSec on your ExpressRoute connections. FastPath is a performance feature. FastPath enables your on-prem traffic to Azure traffic to bypass the ER gateway. We've been supporting this feature for some time. What's new here is we added the new scenarios like Vnet peering and the private link. Last but not least, we are very happy to announce the support of a BGP community on Vnet. So now if you have a hub and a spoke design topology, you can tag your hub Vnet and your spoke Vnets with different BGP community strings. And when you receive these routes in your on-prem, you can apply different routing policies and even security policies to those routes. So we hope this feature will help simplify your network design and management. Now I want to talk about new scenarios and new designs. The first one I want to talk about is Azure Virtual Desktop, formerly known as Windows Virtual Desktop. A common question we received is, does ExpressRoute support Azure Virtual Desktop? Now, before we answer that question, let's take a look at the AVD Azure Virtual Desktop architecture. AVD is built on top of Azure PaaS services. At the center of this architecture is RD Gateway, Remote Desktop Gateway. Now, Remote Desktop Gateway is a multi-tenant service. It facilitates communication between the client and the VMs. Communication happening over the public internet because the RD Gateway has the public IPs. What's new here is the AVD team introduced a new feature called a short path. With a short path, AVD will orchestrate a direct connection between the client and the target machines using the VM's private IP address. So if these virtual machines are connected to your users over a private connection, and these client can reach to the private IPs, then the client will send all the AVD traffic on ExpressRoute on this private connection. So to the question, yes, you can now enable AVD on top of ExpressRoute. The second design I want to talk about is related to ExpressRoute Direct and ExpressRoute Circuit. But first, let's look at what's the concept of ExpressRoute Direct and ExpressRoute Circuit. Now, ExpressRoute Direct is a connectivity model. You can buy a pair of 10G or a pair of 100G ports to connect to us directly. Now, once you set up these physical connections, you can create ExpressRoute Circuit, which is a logical connection on top of these physical connections. Now, let's use an example. So let's say you are connected to us in London. You have three choices for your circuit. Now, let's say you create a local circuit. If you have a local circuit, you can then connect from London to UK South. UK South is a region next to London. You have a standard of the circuit, and then you can connect to all Azure regions in Europe. Now, if you have a premium circuit, and then you can connect to any Azure region in the world, in the US, in Japan, and in Australia. So basically, the circuit SKU defines the scope of access. You can then decide which one to use based on your need and based on your application design. Now, on top of that, we have seen this design. This is a very common design. This design actually also follows our best practice guidance. So this customer connects to us at two peering locations in Amsterdam and in Dublin. They also put the VMs in two regions, West Europe and North Europe. Each circuit is connected to both regions. As you can see, it's a bow tie topology. We call the bow tie topology. So this design gives you reachability and resiliency. But you can actually make a slight modification to the design. Instead of a one standard circuit, you can actually create a local circuit at each peering location. So you can create a local circuit from Amsterdam to West Europe and a local circuit to North Europe. So the benefit of a local circuit is it doesn't charge your data transfer. So if your application have a lot of data to send from Azure to your on-prem, you may find that this design will save you money. That was ExpressRoute. So now let's look at the third service, routing preference. Now, as the name of the service suggests, the service is all about choice. So you can choose between Microsoft network and internet. Now, if you choose Microsoft, you will basically hand off your traffic to an internet hub near you. We'll pick up your traffic and then use our backbone to connect you to your Azure region. That's what we call co-potato routing. Now, you can also choose internet. In that case, your internet service provider will carry your traffic all the way to a POP near your Azure region. And in the return path, we also hand off the traffic there. Your ISP or internet then will take the traffic, send it back to you. That's what we call hot potato routing. Now, hot potato routing can give you a cost benefit. So if you have a lot of data to send, you may want to consider hot potato routing to save you money. The question is how to configure this feature. It's actually very straightforward. When you are creating a public IP, you will see this choice, routing preference. You can choose Microsoft network or internet. Once you create this IP, and you can assign it to a VM or storage account, and then we'll take care of the rest. We'll take care of routing and where to hand off the traffic to your internet service provider. So I have an example for this service, and I'll talk about that in a minute. The last service I want to talk about is Azure Route Server. We launched the service in September. It's a fairly new service. Azure Route Server enables dynamic routing between your MVA and your Vnet. So Route Server will get all the routes in your Vnet and send those routes to the MVA. And the MVA, in return, can send the routes in its own routing, in their own routing table, to the Route Server. And the Route Server will program the MVA routes to the VM's routing table. Now, Route Server is a managed service. Now, one example of that is if you put a Route Server in an AZ region, we'll put the VMs in the Route Server in different AZs. So you will have a zone redundancy by default. You don't have to configure. You don't have to worry about that. The Route Server is also control plane only service, meaning that it does not forward data. So all data forwarding, it will be happening between your MVA and your VMs. So your Route Server will never be a bottleneck. The Route Server relies on BGP as a standard. It's a standard routing protocol. So you can play with the BGP attributes to set up your MVAs to be active-active or active-passive. Now, for more information, please go to ak.ms Route Server. So I want to talk about some designs and scenarios enabled by this new service. The first one I want to talk about is ER VPN transit. Now, imagine you have a VPN gateway and ExpressRoute gateway in one VNet, and they are connected to two different on-prems. Now, without the Route Server, the two on-prems don't talk to each other. Now, if you add the Route Server to the same VNet, and then the Route Server will establish BGP peering with the gateways automatically. And then you can enable route exchange. There's a flag you need to enable. Once you enable that flag, the route exchange, then your VPN on-prem and your ExpressRoute on-prem can talk to each other. So that's what we've been seeing customers taking advantage of this feature. So the next design involves routing preference. Now remember, routing preference enables you to choose between Microsoft network and internet. Now with a Route Server, you can actually connect both networks to your service. Again, to give you an example. So now let's say you are in Japan. You connect to us at the ExpressRoute POP in Tokyo, and then we use our backbone to carry your traffic to the US. And in this example, your VMs are in West US. Now you can add an SD-WAN device to the same VNet. Now in this case, instead of assigning a Microsoft IP to this SD-WAN device, you can assign an internet routing IP to this SD-WAN device. Now let's say something happens in our network. You lose connectivity on the ExpressRoute connection. Now, the Route Server will detect the problem. The Route Server will fail over the traffic to this SD-WAN device. Now, remember, you assign the internet IP to the SD-WAN device. The SD-WAN device will follow the hot potato routing. So we'll basically hand off the traffic to an internet POP near this region, which is Silicon Valley in this example. And then your internet or your internet service provider will pick up the traffic in Silicon Valley and using their backbone to carry the traffic to you in Japan. So with this design, you have an extra level of resiliency. So the last design I want to talk about is Anycast. So Anycast is not supported natively on Azure, but with a Route Server, it's possible now. So that's, again, user example. So you have a number of servers hosting your games, and your users are all over the world. So what you can do is you can put these game machines behind a load balancer, and then your load balancer can advertise its own IP to the Route Server. The Route Server will inject that IP to your network through ExpressRoute. And then what you do is you replicate this design in other Azure regions using the same IPs. So then in your network, you receive the same IP, which is Anycast IP, from multiple locations, and then you do your Anycast configuration. Now, if a user tries to connect to this IP, and depending on their location, and you direct their traffic to the nearby Azure region, and then you have this Anycast design for your applications. So that concludes my presentation. I want to thank you for your time. If you have any questions, please reach out to me.